Blackstone presents Chéri and the End of Chéri by Colette, translated by Rachel Caro. This book is read by Gabrielle de Cuir. Foreword. The Case of Colette. As I have been reading Rachel Caro's brilliantly ingenious, close new translation of Chéri and the End of Chéri, together constituting really the strangest of love stories, I have also been exploring other work by Colette, such as her novel Green Wheat, and extracts from her early fiction and memoirs, and browsing through what her contemporaries wrote about her. I have been musing over the literary figure she presents, and over her reputation here in the United States, as opposed to in France, attempting to reconcile the two and to form a more complete and accurate notion of this important writer. Whereas it is not infrequently said, in France, that she is second only to Proust in importance in 20th century French literature, here in the United States, she is a case apart. She is not always mentioned in the same lists or with the same solemnity as her compatriots Camus, Duras, Sarraute, Bouton, Céline, Gide, and others. Even though she has many admirers in this country, and her works have enjoyed numerous film and television adaptations, and have a well-established place here in college and graduate course reading lists. Is she hurt, even in our day, by the fact that she is a woman writer, and especially one reputed to write mainly about love, though in fact she wrote about so much more, war, nature, childhood, criminal life, theater, etc.? Perhaps the fault is our provincialism, as one Colette-loving friend of mine has said, or I would add, our relatively narrow acquaintance with the large body of her work, which amounts to 40, 50, or is it 80 books? Counts vary. To any French reader, after all, her work is available in its entirety, whereas monolingual Anglophone readers have access only to those books that a publisher has chosen to bring into English via a translator who may or may not be faithful to Colette's very individual style. I wonder if our appraisal of her has been too influenced by our association with the 1944 novella Gigi, perhaps her most famous story, and even more, its adaptations? Could it be that some 70 years ago, the winsome Audrey Hepburn, though chosen by Colette herself to play Gigi in the Broadway play, did her a lasting disservice? On this side of the ocean, we have Broadway and Hepburn, while on the other side, there is the Legion of Honor, the nomination for a Nobel Prize. I'm also speculating about her name. Just a suspicion. But how many, even among those who read her most enthusiastically here in the United States, must assume that Colette is a first name, and a diminutive at that, perhaps similar to certain other rather charming-sounding French words familiar to us ending in ette, soubrette, mignonette, midinette, coquette, and the now rejected as demeaning suffragette. The New Yorker writer Janet Flanner, reporting during many years from her base in Paris, respectfully refers to her as Madame Colette, as do the writer's own fan correspondents. But to most others, she has always been, as they beautifully say, a mononymous author, accent on the second syllable. Colette, however, is not a diminutive, nor a first name, but the surname of her father, Jules Joseph Colette, a military man who, in heroic action, lost a leg in the 1859 war in Italy. Colette, or Captain Colette, or simply the Captain, as his affectionate wife called him, is tenderly described by his daughter in her memoirs Sido and Le Képi, as a would-be writer who, in fact, wrote very little, mainly verses that his daughter criticized for their excessively flowery lyricism. Instead,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.